Okay, everyone. I must warn you, if you are easily scared by phantoms, or if you're offended by dark stories, now is the time for you to stop and exit this tour of Manor House. Otherwise, you enter at your own risk. Discretion is advised. This presentation is produced by Manor House Productions. If you like what you hear, please subscribe to our YouTube channel, like our video, and leave a comment while you're there. Visit ManorHouseShow.com and sign up for the RIP section, where you'll receive Manor House exclusives not found here or anywhere else. Your plot is waiting. And if you make it out alive after tonight's tale, you'll have the option of renting a room out for the night here at Manor House. It'll be an experience you'll never forget.
Tonight's tale is The Invite by Dominic Stabile. Dominic Stabile is a writer of horror fiction and other things, recently transplanted to Blue Hill, Maine from the South. His short fiction has appeared in Sanitarium Magazine, The Horror Zine, Hellfire Crossroads Volume 3, Atticus Review, Far Horizons, and other journals. You can contact him at facebook.com/DominicStabile1 or DominicStabile.com or email him at StabileDominic@Yahoo.com. To read our exclusive interview with Dominic Stabile and for more information on tonight's episode, visit ManorHouseShow.com. Also follow us on Twitter, Facebook, Tumblr, and Instagram.
Follow me. The Phantom Collector awaits.
Welcome. Come in. Don't be scared. At least, not yet. Looks like you received my invitation. We're gonna have so much fun tonight. There are drinks and hors d'oeuvres, games and music. And for the best part of the night, you'll get to try out our new torture rack. That wasn't detailed in your invitation. Oops. Looks like I left out the best part. Sort of like how Jared left out the best part in his invitations in tonight's disgusting detail. He's invited his co-workers to his house under a very false pretense, but with a very nasty purpose. Gather round. Look into the light. Look. Look deep. Open your imagination and listen to the story called The Invite.
Me, Bevan Scott, had been standing around the island of Claire's and Jared's kitchen, munching on half-assed hors d'oeuvres, when Jared pulled the gun. Jared and Claire had just married 2 weeks earlier. An elopement. Jared worked with us at the university bookstore, and had invited us here for what we thought was a belated reception. I hadn't come for the finger foods or well-wishing. I had come to see Claire. When Jared pulled the gun and pointed it at us, Bev started crying and Scott started running his mouth.
What do you think you're doing?
Scott said.
Get over by the sink. All of you.
Fuck you.
We moved over to the sink. It was dark in the room. The late evening sunlight coming through the window over the sink flashed in the glossy metal of the pistol as Jared moved to block the doorway.
It's about Claire.
He took a long pull from a bottle of red wine. Where is she? I had no patience for Jared, and I knew he'd never use the gun. At least, I figured he wouldn't. This had to be some sort of joke.
That's what this is about.
What about? A thought crossed my mind in the silence that followed. Claire left him. Even at gunpoint. That thought came with a big grin.
Claire's changed. She's not the same person anymore. Hell, she's not a person anymore.
We stared at him. What the hell do you mean, Jared? He was shaking his head, as if to ward off his own thoughts.
This isn't about us. Why are you taking it out on us?
He was still shaking his head. You dragged all of us out here. How about you get to the point? Where is Claire and what's with the gun? He looked at me, wiping a stream of snot from his upper lip.
That's the whole problem.
What are you talking about?
Put that fucking gun down and let's see.
It started a few days ago. Claire ran her own veterinary clinic and was coming up on the end of another 16-hour day when the old man walked through her front door. He marched up to the desk and rang the bell twice before realizing she was standing right in front of him.
Sorry, I'm just distracted.
His voice was sweet, if a little affected.
It's okay. What can I do for you?
I wondered if you do house calls.
Honestly, it's never come up. Normally I'd be too busy with clients here to make personal visits.
But you're not too busy now, are you?
Claire smiled as her last client of the night, Tara Lerner, walked past holding her corgi, Douglas. Douglas had heartworms, but Claire was confident they'd caught it early enough that the medication she had prescribed should do the trick. Tara went out through the front doors with a wave and a grateful smile, and Claire looked at the old man.
I'd like to help, but it's been a long day and I'm closing up for the night. Why not bring your pet by tomorrow?
It's no pet,
he said, raising a hand as if to snatch her words right out of the air.
It's a member of my family.
Of course it is. What sort of animal?
The man seemed thrown by the question, and for a moment, she thought she may have offended him. He stumbled over his words, but managed to say,
Horse.
You have a sick horse?
It's urgent. And you see, I don't have a phone. Your clinic is the closest one to my house. I drove straight over as soon as I realized something was wrong.
Claire ran a hand through her hair, trying desperately to hide her agitation. She'd been daydreaming about a bath and a glass of wine since around 9 a.m.
Where do you live?
Somerville. My wife and I, we purchased a place out there after we retired. A few acres of land. We've always loved God's creatures, and we've committed ourselves to treating them well, giving them a happy home. This is why it's so important to me that you come.
There was something about this man. His voice rang with sincerity, but there was more to it. He reminded her of her own grandfather. He'd been a bit eccentric, developing an infatuation with baseball cards in his declining years, just before dementia had taken him. She guessed it made sense that a person might try to cling more firmly to something of Earth as they edged closer toward death. Tired thoughts were often morbid ones.
Of course. Let me grab my purse and I'll meet you outside.
Claire followed the old man for 40 minutes until they ended up on a narrow, tree-lined road, miles from the highway. She entertained the idea the sun might still be out when she got home, but the sun was already long gone, and she hadn't seen a house in 10 minutes. Her headlights played over the cracked pavement, the encroaching rye glass flowing over from the fields like lapping ocean waves. The old man's Cadillac rode ahead, casting a wash of white light over the moss-strewn trees, winking the occasional discarded beer can on the side of the road. His brake lights flashed.
Thank God.
Peering through the windshield toward a dark shape cut out of the sky, a roof. She followed him onto a dirt drive. As soon as she made the turn, he stopped his car. She slammed the brakes. He shut off his headlights, stepped out of his car, and started toward her. In the distance, she could see the hulking shape of a house, and a lower, simpler building next to it, likely a barn. There were no lights going in or around the house. She became anxious as the man moved toward her. What if he was some kind of psycho, and he had led her out here to kidnap her? He was knocking on her window, same sweet look on his face as back at the clinic. She looked at him a moment, biting her lip, then hit the electronic switch to lower the window a crack.
Please switch off your headlights.
And over his voice and the rhythmic bleat of insects, she could hear the ghostly peal of an animal crying out to the night.
What is that?
The headlights, please.
She switched off her lights. The noise died down some.
Was that the horse? I've never heard...
The old man thanked her and hurried back to his car without responding. They parked in front of the house. Up close, the beastly cries filling the night were almost deafening, though they were muted slightly by a rain that had just begun to fall. The old man was already out and moving toward her with an umbrella raised as she stepped out of the car. The cries were coming from the barn. She was reminded of a hot afternoon shortly after she had opened her clinic. A confused citizen had burst through her front door carrying something jagged with bloody, riled feathers. Something that had bellowed mournfully from a black, hooked beak. A vulture. It had been clipped by a truck tire. The sound she now heard was similar to that, but there was an underlying quality to it she couldn't place. Her tired, confused mind tossed up the word sorrowful, although she believed animals to be incapable of such an emotion.
Let's get you inside. We'll have some coffee, dry off, and then I'll show you to her.
Claire welcomed the shelter of the umbrella, but followed the man warily as he led her toward the house.
What's the joke? Jared had paused the story to drink from the wine bottle. I looked toward the entryway beyond Jared. I'd heard a board creak near the stairs. From here, I could see that the living room was dark. A silver blade of light from a street lamp arched down the curtains over the front window.
So when does Claire jump out in white face paint?
Claire's not home yet. She never gets home before dark, anymore.
It had begun to rain, and droplets were rapping gently against the window over the sink. It was dark enough now that Jared should have switched on the light, but he hadn't bothered. I stood there and thought about why we were all here. I thought about it and grinned. If I was right, it was all kind of funny. The last time I had spoken to Claire was just before they had gotten married. They'd been dating a while, and she had gone into the bookstore to bring him his lunch. I caught her in the break room alone and asked her straight up how she could do it. How she could choose him over me. She looked at me like she didn't know what I was talking about. Like I had imagined all the looks she'd given me the semester she had worked with us before she graduated. Like I had misread all the signs she'd been throwing at me. Well, I had her number. I went and told Bev and Scott, our biggest loudmouths, about the night me and Claire had gotten that hotel. Just before she and Jared made it official.
I had told them about how good I'd fucked her. And it looked like word had gotten around to Jared, as I hoped it would. Of course, me and Claire never hooked up, but Jared didn't need to know that. I hadn't expected things to go this far, but it was kind of funny all the same.
Why don't you put the gun down?
None of you are leaving here.
Fuck you.
Why us?
There's more to the story. The old man's house was cramped with poorly arranged furniture, piles of laundry and dirty dishes. Figurines of animals lined the mantel, the end tables, the coffee table, and every other flat surface within view. She moved to the living room carefully, eyeing the figurines as if they fascinated her. In reality, she was wishing she had never come.
Sit where you like. I'll brew some coffee.
She offered a smile and he moved into the kitchen. Cabinets slammed and dishes clattered as he worked. With the old man no longer watching her, she focused her attention on the figurines lining his mantle. Most of them were shaped after predators of all types, carved from wood and polished to a shine. But what caught her attention, and held it, was something housed in a glass case in the center of the mantle. It had the head of a beautiful woman. Long, white blonde hair, full, exposed breasts. Fragile white shoulders sloped gently down until the flesh changed. Now there were black feathers, and where her arms should have been, there were bird wings. The wings were opened out at her sides, giving a cape effect. The plane of her flat midriff went from a snowy white to the black of more feathers. Her legs were sickly thin and the knees bent backward. Her feet were long and narrow, talons arcing from the toes, gripping the earth. She was posed, as if ready to take flight. By the set of her eyes, she had spotted a meal.
My favorite.
She jumped.
So sorry,
he said, handing her a steaming mug of coffee. He had one for himself.
I saw you looking and didn't want to interrupt you. I used to stare at her much the same way. She looks remarkably like my late wife.
Claire sipped her coffee, tried to keep her voice even.
Your wife? I'm sorry, when you mentioned her before, I thought...
I lost her some time ago. I'm still not fond of bringing it up unless it's truly necessary.
I'm so sorry.
Don't be. The Greeks and the Romans called her a harpy, or snatcher. This creature, not my wife.
She laughed out of politeness, but she felt even more uneasy than before at the thought that they were truly alone.
At first, they were thought to be wind spirits. Gorgeous creatures that committed the occasional harmless mischief. Over time, however, history began to depict them as hideous creatures. Monsters.
He had moved around her and was digging for something lodged between the fireplace and a bookshelf, covered in more figurines.
Dante went so far as to include them in his Inferno.
The old man laughed at this. He withdrew a parcel covered in brown paper. He removed the paper and held up a painting. It depicted a dark wood of heavy shadows and mist. Within the trunks and branches of the trees were the writhing souls of the damned. And perched upon the branches were more creatures, like the one in the glass case. Only these were ugly, aged things with swollen, feathered bellies and sallow faces. They looked upon the mournful damned, as if relishing their agony.
That's terrifying.
Gustave Doré.
He set the painting on the sofa and cupped his hands around his coffee mug.
He used to make me so angry. Lies, I would say. God knows why I am so infatuated with them.
With?
Harpies.
What is it that fascinates you about them?
She asked, with an ear on the rein, She hoped it would die down soon, so she could see to his horse and get home with at least enough time to shower before bed. The old man was staring down into his coffee mug.
I've often asked myself that same question, and I think the answer is simple. Their beauty. I first heard mention of them in the stories of Greek mythology my grandmother used to read to me. But they were always in the periphery, never focal characters. And even as a boy, I longed to see these elegant creatures in motion, even if I had to imagine them through stories. I guess I never really grew up.
She smiled and glanced around the room, wanting to change the subject. She saw a photo on an end table. It was a picture of the old man a few years ago with a woman, long, white blonde hair trailing down over her shoulders.
Is that your wife?
The old man smiled and picked up the photo. He stared at it a moment, then handed it to her.
I didn't deserve her.
I'm sure that's not true.
The woman was certainly beautiful, and out of the old man's league for sure. But they looked so happy together.
She's beautiful.
The crowning achievement of my life.
So what did you do before you retired?
I was an anthropologist, which means I taught school.
A professor? I used to think I wanted to teach.
It was a wonderful career, and the students weren't so bad, despite what people say.
He looked toward the window across the room. Rain was still falling heavily.
But I always wanted to travel, uncover relics while roughing it in exotic locales. The stuff you're supposed to accept as fantasy before you finish your undergraduate degree. But I never lost that fire. Even after I blew my one shot at fame, at proving my true thesis.
Thesis?
I'm sorry. You're not here to listen to my sad story.
No, go ahead. Rain, go away.
If you haven't guessed it by now, I have an unusual love for the unusual. Cryptozoology is not considered a credible science. Let's just say I took a sabbatical trip to Greece under the pretense of doing credible research. But I went there for a very different reason.
You were looking to prove the existence of harpies?
When you say it aloud, I can understand why they withdrew my funding. I was lucky they let me hold my teaching position after they found out. I published a boring article here and there and let them tell jokes about me in the hallways.
I'm sorry, that sounds awful.
She looked toward the window. It was still raining. She was stuck here with a nice old man who believed in half-woman, half-bird monsters. She was tired, but not so tired she couldn't acknowledge that in her mind and worry about it.
Please don't be sorry. It was a long time ago, and my wife and I managed to carve out a very pleasant life.
You do have a wonderful home.
She discreetly checked her watch.
I'm keeping you.
No, I just realized I forgot to call my husband. He probably thinks I'm in a ditch somewhere.
Why don't you call him now? When you're done, we can brave the rain, you give my horse a quick look, and have an old man in your debt for the rest of his life.
I heard a door open beyond the entryway. The air shifted, as if someone had just entered the house. But the sound came from upstairs. Jared stopped the story. Claire?
Back, against the counter.
He raised the gun. I heard the sound of something heavy being dragged along a wall upstairs. It was loud a moment. Then cut out. Claire, is that you? Jared laughed, his voice like a wooden paddle striking a tabletop. It was so dark now, I couldn't make out his face. Bev had gone back to crying.
Put down that gun, and we'll see.
Scott kept saying, his hands balled into tight fists.
It's time,
Jared said, pointing the gun at Bev. He gestured toward the stairs just beyond the entryway.
You're all here to see Claire anyways, right? Go on up.
She's here.
She looked towards the stairs, face darkened.
What have you done to her?
She's up there, waiting.
Let me go.
You're last.
Fuck you.
Bev moved past Jared cautiously, then hurried up the stairs calling for Claire.
Claire!
Jared turned to me and Scott and continued the story.
The old man went upstairs to change into more comfortable clothes, and left Claire in the living room to make her phone call. After she hung up and slipped the phone into her pocket, the silence of the room settled on her, the deep sense of isolation. She was 50 feet from her car, and 100 yards from the road, but she felt as if she were floating on an iceberg that had broken away from the mainland and drifted out to sea. The room was cold. The rain had slowed to a drizzle. She stood there in the silence a moment, then realized she needed to use the bathroom. She listened for the old man, not wanting to go searching through his house while he was indisposed, but heard no sounds from upstairs.
What the hell? I'll be quick.
She started down the hallway beyond the fireplace and felt along the wall for a light switch. She found one and flipped it. It clicked up, but nothing happened. She flicked it down and then up again. Nothing. She could see the dark rectangle of a doorway a few feet down the hallway and to the right. She made her way toward it, slipped her hand in, and felt along the wall for the switch. She found it, and this time it worked. The bathroom filled with glorious light. The bathtub was full of human body parts. A man's leg stuck up from the pile, the foot flat and pointing outward like a flag. About it was a tangle of arms and legs and hands and feet. Coils of pink viscera snaked through a pool of chunky blood. Blood had spilled over the side of the tub and onto the floor. She was standing in blood. When she pulled back her foot, there was a sticky sound. There was a man's head in the sink. He had light brown hair, almost blonde. There was a flesh-colored mole under the ridge over his right eye. His mouth was open, revealing starkly white teeth.
She likes him clean.
Claire turned around and looked at him. He was aiming a revolver at her. In his other hand was a spear. She stood still, her hands folded in front of her, as if in church. Her body had gone numb.
I found, too, that if I cut them into pieces, they last longer. You put a whole man in front of her, she'll eat him just because he is there. Then I have to go find more.
What about your horse?
Her mind was empty of all thoughts.
That was a white lie to get you here. I knew you wouldn't come if I told you the truth.
You lied.
She said it the way a heartbroken child would say it.
A white lie. But she is sick. I know you can help her. You helped a dog of mine once. I saw the way you handled him. The way you talked to him. You have a wonderful way with God's creatures. Come on, let's go see to her. Then you can get home to your husband.
Claire followed him down the hallway and out the door. As she walked on numb feet, she thought of the sound she had heard coming from the barn. Those bird-like sounds.
Under the pretense of doing credible research.
Sorrowful. That was the word that had come to her when she heard those terrible cries. Sorrowful.
But I went there for a very different reason.
Their shoes squelched over the now soggy lawn as they moved toward the barn. The rain had stopped, but a sharp cold had entered the air. The sounds coming from the barn had quieted, as if the creature inside had been rocked to sleep by the gentle rain. They stopped outside the door to the barn.
"I've got this for her,"
he said, holding up the spear.
"This should keep her calm while you look her over."
He held out the gun.
"I've got this for you, in case you try to run. Don't let her scratch or bite you either. That's the whole reason we're in this mess."
Claire stared at him. He took an oil lantern off a rusty hook jutting from the side of the barn. He drew a match from his pocket and lit the lantern. It cast a soft glow.
"This doesn't bother her as much. Not like electric lights."
Claire nodded numbly and took the lantern from him. He placed a hand against the barn door, then paused.
"Don't scream. Loud noises can also aggravate her."
Claire nodded again, and he pushed the door open.
When Bev began to scream upstairs, Scott lost it and went for Jared. Jared raised the gun and shot Scott in the face. Scott's head snapped back, and he dropped to the floor in a way that was almost graceful. Thankfully, I couldn't see the wound in Scott's face through the dark, but I could hear the patter of his blood dripping onto the floor, and I could smell metal, shit, and gun smoke in the air. Things weren't so funny anymore. There was another sound from upstairs. Through my ringing ears, it sounded like a high wind being forced through a narrow metal opening. It made all the hairs on my arms and neck do a dance. For a second, I felt like I was tumbling head over heels down a hill in the dark of a moonless night. Then I realized my eyes were closed. I was on the floor with my arms thrown over my head, rocking back and forth. It took me another moment to realize that I was screaming. I pinched my lips shut. Muscles tensed, I raised my head. Jared was still in the doorway, with the gun on me. "What's happening?" I said. And through the gun smoke still clouding the air, he continued the story.
The hinges of the barn squealed as the old man pushed it open, and in response, horrible cries issued from within. However, as soon as Claire shined the light in the open doorway, the cries stopped. Something heavy scampered away toward the far wall. A chain rattled. The lantern cast a circle of light a short distance ahead. She saw disturbed earth and a thick wetness mixed with strands of hay. Beyond that was a wall of darkness. She took a few steps forward, and then a smell hit her. It was like nothing she'd ever smelled before. She turned and vomited. The old man placed a hand on her back. He had the spear held out ahead of them.
"It's okay."
Claire wiped her mouth and started forward again. As she moved, the circle of light cast by the lantern revealed more of what lay on the floor of the barn. Chewed limbs, ripped torsos, splashes of blood and strands of dried skin, curled up like burnt paper. She moved around a naked man whose body was unharmed, except for the pulpy, round hole in his belly, from which all of his organs had been removed. The smell got to her again. She turned toward the wall to her left and vomited over the picked skeleton of a child. When she saw what it was, she slapped a hand over her mouth and muffled a scream. She felt the barrel of the pistol pressed into her back.
"She's back here."
"You feed her?"
"She has to eat. But don't worry, that's not why you're here. Just make her better, and this will all be over."
"What if I refuse?"
"If you won't fix her up, then I'll find another use for you. Do you know how difficult it is to kidnap people?"
"You're sick."
"Agreed. Now move."
Claire made herself push forward. The sooner she finished this, the sooner she could leave. If he was truly going to let her leave. The smell grew worse as she moved through the barn, The bloody mud squelched beneath her feet. In the passing glow of the lantern, she saw bodies heaped along the walls. Something dripped on her face from above. She didn't look up. A moment later, she walked into a tube of intestine hanging from a rafter. It left a cold wetness on her cheek as she passed on.
"Sweetheart,"
the old man said into the darkness.
"I brought you a doctor. She's going to help."
A horrible squeal pierced the foul air. It was closer than Claire had thought. She stopped cold.
"Go on,"
the old man said, pressing the pistol into her back. She raised the lantern higher and stepped forward. It was leaned against the far wall, a massive feathered wing drawn up to shield its eyes from the light. A long clawed foot stretched across the floor, the three toes flexing black talons as the creature mewed. The legs were covered in ruffled, black feathers that went up to a swollen belly. Saggy white breasts hung down to rest on the belly like stuffed socks, the nipples black and hard. Claire lowered the lantern slightly, and the creature moved its wing to look at her. The face was a fleshy spearhead, the mouth and nose projected forward like a snout. The mouth opened from ear to ear to reveal rows of small, sharp teeth. The smell was worse here, and Claire pinched her lips shut and focused on maintaining consciousness as she moved closer. The old man pointed the spear at the creature.
"It's okay, sweetheart. This nice lady is here to help."
The creature shrieked, but up close Claire could see it had a sort of smile on its face. It released a quick, high-pitched sound that reminded her of a baby's squeal of approval.
"She likes you."
Claire made a sound, but she wasn't aware of it.
"You'll be fine."
Claire nodded. She was afraid to blink.
"I'm going to have to look at you, okay?"
The creature's eyes were black. Claire couldn't read them.
"Go ahead."
Claire raised the lantern and leaned in. The creature's stench was thick in the air. She moved the light over its body, looking for signs of trauma in the pale flesh. Where there weren't feathers, there were patches of thick white hair matted with filth and blood. Fat skin tags hung from it like balled fists. She couldn't tell if the bloodied places were wounds or not.
"I have to feel around."
"Go ahead. She likes you."
Claire hesitated, then said,
"Tell me if this hurts."
She began to feel around in the bloodier areas of the creature's body, applying pressure and waiting for a reaction. Its flesh was cold and clammy. It left a film on her fingertips. The creature didn't make a sound. It watched her work, its black eyes following her, its lips curled back over its teeth, a purple tongue lolling within its mouth like a molting snake. She had nearly given up when she noticed a redness on the flesh of its neck, around which there was a steel shackle attached to a long chain that trailed down and across the floor to a metal post cemented into the ground.
"It's her bonds. They've caused an infection."
"Well, that's not so bad."
"We'll need some antibacterial and bandages."
"I've got a kit in the car just outside."
Claire was focused on the redness lining the creature's throat. She stretched her hand out and lightly touched the affected area. The creature shrieked and clamped down on her hand. A dozen needle-like teeth popped her skin, tearing through flesh. She pulled her hand away and fell back. The creature didn't come after her. It stayed where it was and mewed apologetically. She inspected her hand. It didn't look as bad as it felt. A semicircle of red holes crossed her hand. A droplet of blood rose from each. When the old man returned, he removed the shackle and held the spear on the creature as Claire dressed its throat. Her body had taken over now. Muscle memory allowed her to work through the fog of unbelief floating around her. When she was done, she stood up and walked out of the barn without a word. The old man followed her out and shut and locked the barn behind them. The rain had picked up slightly.
"I want to thank you. I know it's not easy to see a thing like that."
"She'll need to take antibiotics twice a day. That's assuming harpies and humans share similar immune systems. I have a bottle in my car I can give you.
I appreciate that very much.
So you're letting me leave?
I don't see why not.
You don't?
I suppose you could report me to the police. Tell them about how I'm kidnapping locals and feeding them to a harpy. I will certainly keep my ears open for approaching sirens.
I could leave out the part about the harpy.
All of this will be gone soon. Once she's better, she'll take care of the evidence fairly quickly.
Can you answer me something?
I say you've earned it.
You told me not to let her bite or scratch me. Why?
My wife was bitten in Greece.
Claire stared at him, waiting for him to elaborate. But her heart began to race. The old man shrugged.
Well, you saw her. She look all right to you?
I hadn't moved from the floor. I was just lying there, listening to Jared's story. And all the while, there was Bev screaming upstairs. And that other sound. A grating, furious sound. I guess I was in shock from the screams and that sound and from seeing Scott die. I was numb. My eyes were blurred over with tears. I fancy myself a tough guy, but you wouldn't have thought so, seeing me just then. Jared was wavering on his feet, drunk and no doubt mad. He was just laughing. The wetness of his eyes glimmered in the streetlight coming through the window. And I knew those eyes were on me. And he was savoring the thought of me meeting whatever was up there. And I thought it that way, although I knew what Jared wanted me to believe was up there. He wanted me to believe Claire had changed, become some kind of monster. I couldn't believe that. But I could get mad at the thought that he had hurt her somehow, and that's what I did. I wiped my eyes and stood up. He was laughing, that mad look in his eyes. When he saw me moving towards him, he raised the gun, but fired too soon. The bullet grazed my leg and sent me spinning. I moved around the island, keeping low and hoping he'd lose me in the dark. My leg stung, but I barely noticed it. Bev stopped screaming. It was sudden. Like someone stuck something down her throat to shut her up. Something heavy hit the floor upstairs. And then everything went quiet. I kept low and didn't move.
It took a few days. She got so sick, but refused to go to the doctor.
He was pacing and allowed his feet to drag over the floor. I moved around the island, keeping it between us.
I didn't understand why. She couldn't go to work. Then she couldn't get dressed. And then she couldn't get out of bed. She made me staple blankets over the bedroom windows. I had to keep all the lights in the house off.
He had stopped moving. I stayed where I was and listened.
Her skin started to flake away. My wife's face peeled off. I collected the peels in a bowl and covered it with plastic wrap and put it in the fridge. I thought, I don't know, they could reattach it or something. That was when I told her I was calling the doctor. And she made me sit down and told me the story I just told you.
I didn't hear the shuffling of his feet anymore, but his voice had drawn closer on that last line. I slowly reached over the island. Feeling for the knife he'd used to cut cheese for the hors d'oeuvres. Nothing. His feet slid over the floor. He was moving around the left. I quietly moved right, staying low, I felt around the edge of the island as I moved, looking for the knife.
I'm not going to kill you.
I found the knife. His feet shuffled.
I'm going to let your lover...
His voice was right above me. I jumped up and thrust the knife towards the sound. It slipped into something soft, and a hot wetness flowed out over my hand. Jared made a quick choking sound, and a warm mist settled over my face. I licked my lips and tasted iron. He tried to say something else, but his mouth wouldn't work. I could see the glint of his eyes in the light from the window, but it was different now. The madness was gone, and all that was left was how it looked when Jared got sad. A look he'd worn to work every day until the day he landed Claire instead of me. It was good to see that look again. I enjoyed it for a second, then noticed movement to my right. A flash of blonde hair in the dark, a rush of disturbed air. Then, nothing. I didn't move. I was still staring at the doorway where I'd seen the shadow when I felt heat on my neck. A soft breath moved my hair, and then the sound came, inches from my ear. My legs went numb, and I dropped to the floor and twisted away from the sound. I crab-walked towards the kitchen table. Blood was pouring out of my ear and a loud bell rang inside my head. The shape moving toward me couldn't be Claire. Claire had always been a finely built, athletic woman, trim and classically beautiful. This was the creature from Jared's story. As it passed through the light from the window, I saw the sharp angle of the face, a set of black eyes. Claire? Claire didn't answer. I got to my feet and ran around the kitchen table. I picked up a chair and jabbed at it with the legs of the chair as it came after me. Shrieks filled the room like waves of heat moving through my head. The air was thick with its smell, with the misty tang of its breath. I moved around the table, screaming. I pissed myself. I thought of my mother. I called for her as the thing shrieked at me. It overturned the table, swept the chairs out of the way with one massive swing. I fell against the wall, the chair forgotten. It stood over me, and I waited to be eaten. I was looking forward to it, in fact. Not the pain, but the release. I couldn't move past this. No one could, but me, especially. I was in love with the woman this creature used to be. That woman was gone. I had nothing else. I closed my eyes. It was a long time before I opened them again. When I did, the creature was across the room, eating Jared. After that, it ate Scott. It bit through flesh and bone like so much pizza crust. I listened to bones snap, skin rip. Organs were sucked and swallowed like oysters. If I wasn't mad before, I was mad by the end of that first meal. Yes. I said first. There have been quite a few since. She has to be fed, after all. The old man and Jared both knew that. And now I know it.
Speaking of, the cableman's here, so I need to wrap up. We don't have cable, but he doesn't know that. The sun's almost gone down, and it's about dinner time.
That reception turned into a feast. Unfortunately for the guest, they were the main dish. Now that Jared is no longer in the nest, the two little lovebirds can be together forever. Ah, the torture rack. Now that's what I call breaking it in. I hope you enjoyed tonight's tale. Until the next one, won't you stay the night forever?